Good evening, everybody, and a warm welcome to another second episode of IAP Cochin Branch Initiative PG Clinic. This is mainly targeted for the PGs to present cases so that they become more confident during the exams. Today we have Dr. Nita, who is a final year DNB resident at Rajagiri Hospital, and to chair the session we have Dr. Hariprasad, who is a professor at Government Medical College, Kalamacheri. Over to Dr. Hariprasad, sir, for further proceedings. Thank you.
So, thank you, Pramod Vairi. I think at the outset, let me congratulate the IAP Cochin branch for taking this great initiative of academics, especially for our young postgraduate students. I think this will be a very good start, and I hope this will be of very useful for all the PGs. So I think we'll go to the session directly. Nita, I think you're a little bit tense. Don't be tense, because I think this is only a learning experience. So,
okay, sir.
And again, you are, I think, are you a final year?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So very soon you will be going for the presentation for the exam. So,
okay.
So take this as an experience. So be comfortable, cool. This is just a discussion.
Okay.
So my exam present is another in the present here. And to all other participants, I think it will be better if you put your video on, because it's an interactive session. That is one thing. Second, we feel free to interact so that this is a discussion. So it's a give and take policy, so that you may get something from me, and I will also gain a lot of from you, because all of you are you are in the learning period, and definitely some faculties or some other working pediatricians may also be there. So I think without wasting our time, we'll go to the discussion. I think we'll do something. Nita, you start the presentation, and you have a presentation complete in the history. And at the end of history taking, we'll have a detailed discussion on the history, because elaboration of the history is very, very important in pediatrics. Because at the end of history taking, we should have a diagnosis.
Okay.
So we'll have a discussion. At the end of history, at the end of a presentation of the history, and followed by that, we'll go for the examination. Then we'll have a final discussion.
Okay.
So we'll go to Nita. Over to Nita.
So shall I start?
Yeah, definitely. You can start.
Okay. Good evening, everyone. So, this is baby Ivanjo Shindo. He was an 8-month, 22-days-old boy. He was coming from Thrissur, Chalakudi, and his informant is mother. Reliability is good, and he was admitted here on 17-11-2020, and I have examined him on the same day. So, chief complaints. He had fever for 7 days, yellowish discoloration of urine for 5 days, decreased activity for 3 days, and mild abdominal distension for 2 days. So, history of presenting illness. The baby was apparently normal 1 week back of the examination. So then he had fever, which was of 7 days duration, which was low grade, intermittent, which was not associated with chills or rigor, which was relieved by medication. They have given paracetamol, which was given in the correct dose, 15 mg per kg per dose. And there was no aggravating factors, which was not associated with rash, and which was not associated with respiratory symptoms like cough or cold. And he had decreased activity of fever, activity during the fever spikes, but he was active other times. Then he had yellowish discoloration of urine on third day of fever, that is for 5 days, and all his nappies were stained with golden yellow color, which was not blood stain, not associated with which was not associated with crying or straining during maturation, and was passing urine adequately. Mother didn't notice any yellowish discoloration of skin or eye at that time. No history of increased paleness, no history of clay-colored stools or bleeding stools or increased frequency of stools or altered consistency of stools. So On the third day of fever, he was taken to a local hospital where oral antibiotic was given. Just cefixime was given of 10 mg per kg per day in two divided dose, and it was given for 2 days. Then mother noticed on the fourth day of fever, baby had decreased activity, which was for 3 days duration. He was not interested in surroundings. He was not playing as usual. He was sleeping most of the time, most of the day and night, and was irritable in between, but he was taking feeds as usual. So then mother also noticed mild abdominal distension, which was on the fifth day of fever, which is of 2 days duration, which was associated with vomiting. Vomiting was non-projectile, non-bilious, non-blood stained, and which contained digested food particles. So on fifth day, this baby, due to the persistence of all these symptoms, baby was taken to a local hospital where doctor detected yellowish discoloration of eyes and skin, hence he was referred to higher center, where he got admitted, where he was then undergone multiple blood investigations and ultrasound scan, and it has been noticed that there is some problem in the liver. So he was treated with IV antibiotics and some other medications for the 3 days. So on the seventh day, he had persistence of symptoms, and hence he was referred here for a request for further treatment. So going to the negative history, there was no history suggestive of any infections like food intake from outside, similar illness in the family, any history of loose stools, blood transfusion, travel, conjunctival congestion, playing in muddy water, exposure to rodents, weight loss, evening rise of temperature, or contact with TB. There is no history of any hepatotoxic drug intake other than paracetamol, which we have told, which was taken in the correct dose. And there is no history of any Ayurvedic medication intake or herbal medication intake. There is no history suggestive of any metabolic disorders like recurrent vomiting, seizure, history suggestive of hypoglycemia, altered sensory during the past infections, or there was no history of any abnormal movements or hyperpigmentation. Then there was no history suggestive of autoimmune disorders like photosensitive rash, oral ulcers, or arthritis. There was no history suggestive of malignancy like weight loss, recurrent infections, bleeding manifestation. There was no history suggestive of immunodeficiency like recurrent infections, abscess, seborrhea, or oral thrush. There was no history of any altered sleep rhythm, seizure, edema, bleeding manifestations, or constipation. So past history, there is no history of any contact with tuberculosis, there is no history of blood transfusion, or there is no history of any hospital admission. So antenatal history. So in the first trimester, mother conceived at 24 years of age. It was spontaneous conception. It was 1.5 years after the first delivery. Pregnancy was confirmed by BUPT, which was done 6 weeks after the missing periods. She had undergone regular antenatal checkups. Dating scan was done in the first trimester, which was normal. No history of any unsupervised drug intake or radiation exposure. No history of fever with rash or lymphadenopathy. No history of bleeding PV. No history of hypothyroidism. No history of hypermesis gravidarum for the mother. And she has taken iron and folic acid tablets. So second trimester, quickening was felt at 5th month. There's no history of medical disorders complicating pregnancy like pregnancy-induced hypertension or diabetes mellitus. There's no history of any liver-associated disorder in the mother during pregnancy or itching during pregnancy. There is no history of bleeding per vagina. Anomaly scan was done, which showed no fecal anomalies, no history of polyhydramnios or oligohydramnios. There was no history of growth retardation. Then also, she has done the serology test, which was normal, and she has taken 2 doses of TT. Iron and calcium tablets were taken. So on the third trimester, she was appreciating good fetal movements. There was no history of PH or GDM. She has taken the growth cell, the growth scan, which was normal interval growth, no history of polyhydramnios. There was no history of bleeding or leaking per vagina. There was no history of urinary tract infection or respiratory tract infection or intake of any antibiotics. And she had adequate weight gain during pregnancy. So birth history, the baby was born as term. He was a 38-weeker. Emergency LSCS was done because of fetal bradycardia, but he was cried immediately after birth. His birth weight was 2.5 kg. So postnatal history, he had a mild respiratory distress soon after the birth. So he was kept in NICU and he was started on oxygen support for 2 days. Mother says that it was started via nasal prongs. Then after 2 days, he was on room air. So he was started on initially on pyrite feeds for 1 day, but then on direct breastfeeds. He passed urine and meconium within the first 24 hours of life. There was no history of any pallor or cyanosis. There is no history of staining of diaper or pale colored stools. There is no history of phototherapy or TPN administration, or no history of any umbilical vein catheter insertion. There is no history of hypoglycemia or vomiting or seizure or infection or feeding difficulty in the neonatal period. There is no history of blood transfusion in the neonatal period or IV antibiotics, and he was discharged on the 4th day of life. So developmental history. So it's an 8-month-old baby. So his gross motor development was, he attained his cut control at 3 months of age. He had a rollover at 5 months of age. And he started to sit with support at 6 months of age. Now he can sit without support. and crawling has no touch. Then so it is appropriate for his age. Then fine motor, he has a bitester stage by 3 to 4 months, and he has unitester stage by 6 months. And now he can transfer the objects, and he's having immature principles. So social history is he was having social skills at 2 months of age. He started recognizing his mom at 3 months of age. Then he started to smile at the mirror image by 5th month of age. Then he had a stranger anxiety by 6th month. Now he can patch images on selfie mirror. So language, he says monosyllables. Missional hearing, he follows objects and turns towards the side of sound. And his terminal history appears to be normal. So diet history, the baby was on exclusive breastfeeds till 6 months of life. Then weaning was started with rice kuruk, banana, ragi kuruk, etc. So as per bedside calculation, the expected calorie intake is 750 kilocalorie per day, and he's getting 680 kilocalorie per day. Then expected protein intake is 15 grams per day, and he's getting 16.6 grams per day. Both are adequate. Immunization history. His BCG scar is present. He's immunized to H according to national immunization schedule. Optional vaccines like pneumococcal and rotavirus was not taken. So family history. He's the second born of non-consanguineous marriage. He has one sibling, 2-year-old girl. She's developmentally normal and she has no similar illness. There is no history of abortion or stillbirth or neonatal death in the family. There is no history suggestive of any liver disorder in the family. There is no history suggestive of any psychiatric disorder in the family. There is no history of colostone or cholecystectomy or leg ulcers in the family. There is no history suggestive of any transfusion-dependent anemias or chronic drug intake or chronic illness like rheumatic or autoimmune disorder in the family. So socioeconomic history, mother is a poor woman, father owns a shop. He belongs to a lower middle class family according to modified Kupuswami scale. They live in a pakka house, no overcrowding. He drinks water from well, uses boiled and cool water. Proper sewage disposal is present, and they are not using copper vessels for cooking. So from the history, so this is a 6-month-old male child. He's well-nourished, immunized to age, and developmentally normal with no significant past or antenatal, natal, or postnatal history. He came with history of fever for 7 days, jaundice for 5 days, lethargy and irritability for 3 days, and abdominal distension for 2 days. So I think it would be probably a case of infective hepatitis since it has been started after the onset of fever. And since he's irritable and he's having all the time he's sleeping, he might be going into an early encephalopathic stage. Sir, can you continue with the examination?
No.
Okay, sir.
We'll do one thing.
Okay, sir.
Including the dam, all of you take just 1 minute or to write down the differential diagnosis. You have made your first diagnosis, that is infective hepatitis with early features of encephalopathy. Yes. So I think you can write down your differential diagnosis also, and you can tell me. And all others can also take just 1 minute and write down it, diagnosis or differential diagnosis based on the history till now. And then at the end of 1 minute, we'll have a discussion on the history, and we'll come to the differential diagnosis, followed by that we'll go to the examination. Okay, so after 1 minute you just neither you go to the first slide.
Okay, sir.
Okay, okay. Right, so first you write to a differential diagnosis, then we'll go to the first slide. Okay. So you can take the first layer, and then we'll proceed from there.
Okay, sir.
Okay. So it's a male or female?
It's a male boy.
Why that question?
Because sir, certain disorders are more common in boys as compared to girls. For example, yes, sir. Like Duchenne muscular dystrophy, Duchenne muscular dystrophy. Then.
No, with a reference to this child.
Okay, sir. With a reference to this child, autoimmune hepatitis are more common in girls. Okay.
Okay. Take your next slide. Next slide.
Okay.
Okay. So next. Next. Okay. No. Previously.
Okay.
Previous.
Okay.
So here you said there's a history of fever for 7 days, followed by low grade intermittent fever, and you have specifically said decreased activity during fever and but active in between. Okay. Why you said that statement?
Because sir, after 5 days fever, he had decreased activity during all the time, not only during the fever but other time also. So I have specifically mentioned here to say that like during fever spikes only he had decreased activity, other times he was like active and playful, sir.
So what does that indicate? Does it indicate a viral infection or a bacterial infection? Or what? How will you differentiate between a viral and bacterial infection based on this history? Others can also contribute. It will be too tasky for Nida. Your friends are there? Your friends have come?
Yes, sir.
If any of friends of Nida is there, I think it's better for them also to. Please, if possible, put on a video also, because being a discussion, it is not fair to keep the video off. Okay, so if possible, please put on your video and you can also take part in active discussion. So what are the points to differentiate between a viral and bacterial infection from the history?
In the active infection, baby will be more compared to viral infection, and viral infections can be associated with either prodromal symptoms.
Yeah, that is it. So viral infection, usually it will be associated with the prodromal symptoms like running nose or cough or congestion or rash, where usually bacterial infection is not associated with that. Second, bacterial infection, if it is bacterial infection, the child will continue to be sick even if the child is febrile. Whereas if it's a viral infection, generally the child will become quiet when the child is febrile. But once the fever is controlled with the paracetamol, what will happen? The child will become active. So this sentence indirectly indicates that probably this child is having a viral infection. Okay. Then what is the next point? Usually viral infection will not have a focus of infection, whereas bacterial infection usually will have a focus of infection. Okay, like a boil or carbon or abscess. And generally viral infection will subside within 5 to 7 days, whereas bacterial infection will respond only to specific antibiotic with specific treatment with antibiotic. Okay. So these are the 5 points to be mentioned whenever you are asked to differentiate between a viral and bacterial infection.
Okay.
Now, coming to the next point, that is, you said there is yellow discoloration of urine and the nappies are stained golden yellow in color. So what does that mean?
This is to just in case of conjugated hyperbilirubinemia, there can be golden yellow in color urine.
Okay, so that means you are indirectly mean that child is having jaundice, and this jaundice is mainly due to conjugated hyperbilirubinemia. Now I think this is the most catching point in this history. So now you have to tell me what are the causes of cholestasis after the newborn period, which can cause the staining of the nappies.
Cholestasis, it can be caused by sepsis.
We'll take infection first. Which are the infections that can present with jaundice in this 9-month old baby?
Sir,
Okay, so we'll take one by one. First, you said infection. Which are the infections you should consider in this type? Because whenever you come across a such a condition, you should always be optimistic. You should always think of curable causes first.
Okay.
So what are the infections that can present in this way? Fever, yellow discoloration with a decreased activity.
Like viral infections, like viral hepatitis.
Okay.
Dengue fever can present.
Okay.
Malaria can present.
Okay.
That's rare in our area. Epstein-Barr virus infection.
Okay.
Then, sir, CMV, cytomegalovirus infections can present.
That wasn't the same.
Mm. Okay, sir. Which can also be caused by the bacterial infections like typhoid, sir.
Okay. One more, anything more? One most important.
TB.
TB also.
Okay, then.
One acute infection.
Leptospirosis.
We'll come to that. Yes, I'm going to have, I think everybody can contribute. Okay, so I think she has mentioned almost everything. So I think again here we can think of acute infection, chronic infection. Okay, so the first when you take acute infection here, I think you have to consider urosepsis. That means urinary infection. Okay, so UTI is one condition, especially in infants, that can take any form. They can present as diarrhea. That is known as, what do you call that, Nida? Diarrhea secondary. Yeah, very good. Parenteral diarrhea. So, parenteral diarrhea. So, upon diarrhea occurring secondary to UTI is known as parenteral diarrhea. So, similarly, sometimes failure to thrive may be the only manifestation of UTI. Okay. So, similarly, urosepsis is one condition where child can present with the fever, irritability, and jaundice. Why irritability? Because it can cause spinal nephritis, and mainly it is caused by they have negative infection like E. coli, and it can cause irritability. So, the first infection, you have to consider urosepsis as the first one.
Okay.
And again, you said it is a male child.
Okay.
Like,
yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. So, what additional question will you ask when considering UTI here?
Phimosis.
Phimosis, will you call a 9-month old baby having phimosis?
No, sir.
Because actually it is physiological up to 1 year.
Okay, sir.
They already, I think you had to ask for the urinary stream. Why?
Posterior
urethra bag. So, being a male child, you should definitely ask for the presence of what about the urinary stream. Is it good or not? Okay. Then what are other aspects? You have to ask for constipation, because constipation will aggravate or precipitate UTI. Then, whether deworming, because pinworm infestation, it's a 9-month old baby, it has already started crawling and creeping, isn't it?
Okay.
So,
yes,
worm infestation can occur.
Okay,
then, hygiene of the perineum. So, these are some very basic question that should be asked here. Okay. So always you should include these points also in the history. So that is regarding the UTI. Second, you said this can be malaria. Can this be malaria? And if it is malaria, what type of malaria?
The possibility of malaria is very rare, sir. In our area, it is very rare. Second, the fever was not associated with any chills or rigors. Mm-hmm. And there was no history of any paler.
Okay. Anybody else? I think we have got so many pages. No one is contributing. And I think it's better not to put it in the chat box. It's a discussion. Okay. So please, all of your pages. And if you find shy to talk, even with the video off, it will be very difficult for you to face exam. So please come out. First, you respond to my questions, and if possible, you put on your video also. Because all of you will have to face exam directly to the examiner, not through webinar or okay. So, it is always better to take active participation in discussion. So I think malaria is a possibility in here. Okay, Nida, why?
Okay,
so because malaria, one thing, malaria is endemic here. We need not travel outside to get malaria. That is one thing. Second, can this be congenital malaria? Anybody? Can this be congenital malaria? It can be. Why? Usually, even though the usual duration of the period at which congenital malaria occurs is between 10 to 30 days. That is the first 30 days of life. But it has been documented from 40 numbers. That means that congenital malaria can be diagnosed starting from 40 numbers and can sometimes last for several months. So child is just 9 months, and so malaria, either it is congenital or acquired malaria, can occur. And whenever any child having jaundice in a child with malaria, you have to classify as what type of malaria based on the WHO criteria. Anybody? It is severe malaria. Okay. I think as a postgraduate student, you should know all this. Okay. So upon, you have to consider severe malaria here. It can either be congenital or it can be acquired. Okay. So, and what are other features of WHO criteria for severe malaria other than jaundice?
There can be metabolic acidosis, severe pallor.
Okay. Clinically, yeah, very good. Severe pallor. You are a clinician. So as far as possible, you answer the clinical aspects. Okay. But investigation will go, we'll discuss later.
Okay. Okay. So there can be seizure.
Yeah, very good. So they can have a severe anemia, they can have jaundice, they can have seizure, they can have loss of consciousness, they can present with shock. Okay. So second possibility, I think you have to consider, being a treatable cause, you have to consider and severe malaria cause. Okay. Third, you said enteric fever. Can this be enteric fever?
Yes, sir, this can be, sir.
Is it common to have enteric fever in a 9-month-old baby?
Less common.
Anybody else? You take the next slide. Next slide. Okay. Enteric fever is a possibility. Why? Again, enteric fever is endemic in our community.
Okay.
In general, enteric fever usually occur not will not occur less than in infants. Okay. But in certain situations, especially if the child is prone to have having a viral infection, his immunity is a little bit low. Such situations, enteric fever can occur. And generally, this is the classical manifest of enteric fever in infants. Will not get the classical cephalopolysar type of fever. They will have fever, they will have irritability, child will be toxic, and some children will have jaundice also. So you cannot rule out or completely rule out enteric fever without investigation. Okay. So third possibility, as you said, this can be enteric fever as a part of infection.
Okay.
Then you said, can this be dengue?
Yes, sir.
Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Is it common to have dengue, jaundice in dengue, and what's the cause of jaundice in dengue? Anybody else? Is that you put there, you lay?
Yes,
sir. Is that you put there, I will call you. Okay, I will call my PGS. Bharati. Parathi is there? What is the cause of jaundice or in dengue fever?
Hepatitis.
See, jaundice occurs in dengue in two mechanisms. One, it can occur as a part of ischemia. So you know the basic pathology of dengue and the Mattevaki Parnandani, it is capillary fragility. It is capillary fragility. Okay. The capillaries become fragile. So what will happen? There will be movement of fluid in and out of the tissues. So that is why you can have dengue shock syndrome as well as dengue hemorrhagic fever. they can go in for shunt, they can also present with failure. Okay. So as a part of dehydration, as a part of ischemia, the liver cells are affected, and you will have significantly elevated liver enzymes and a little bit of jaundice, but that will get rapidly corrected by rehydration. So one type of jaundice get rapidly corrected where the enzymes will be in thousands, and that is secondary to ischemia. And secondary is, as you said, where the dengue virus involving or affecting the liver, that is by inflammation. Okay, so these are the two mechanisms by which dengue can have jaundice. And again, here again, an infant can have fever and irritability, so dengue is a possibility. But if it is dengue fever, what is your classification of dengue here? And then, do you want to qualify the dengue? Anybody else? Manitaja, Rice?
Undifferentiated
Mitra? Dengue. Hello? Anybody?
Undifferentiated dengue fever.
Undifferentiated dengue. Oh, no. Somebody has said dengue with warning. What are the warning signs of dengue?
Persistent vomiting. Persistent vomiting. Ah. Severe abdominal pain.
Headache. Okay. So, I'm arranging that. Jaundice will not occur in warning sign. Once a patient develops warning and jaundice, that means either he is going for dengue shock syndrome. Anxiety. So it is severe dengue. Okay, so that is very important. So here, it's a very short duration, just 7 days of fever, 5 days of jaundice, and 3 days of poor acuity. That means it is the disease is slowly progressing, and 2 days of abdominal distension. So probably, if it is dengue, the child is going for a complication. So it is severe dengue, probably going for a dengue shock syndrome. Okay, so that's another second. Okay, can you think of, then you said hepatitis, right? Okay, can be any type of hepatitis, can be A to E. A agam, B agam, C agam, D agam, E agam. Okay. So do you want to ask for any further questions to differentiate these different types of hepatitis?
Yes, sir.
And can this be acute hepatitis?
Sir, any history of blood transfusion, you can ask. Throughout hepatitis, any history of blood transfusions we can ask. Then history of to rule out hepatitis B and C. Then to rule out hepatitis A and E, similar illness in the family. Then eating from outside.
Okay, so is it? I'm just asking one question. Is it common to have poor activity or lethargy in a child with acute hepatitis? Because a child was sleeping all the time. Mm-hmm. Child is irritable. Is it common to have irritability in a child with the hepatitis? In between?
Less common, sir.
And what does that indicate? As you said, early sense of encephalopathy. So you cannot make a diagnosis of acute hepatitis alone here. Okay. So one thing, if it is hepatitis A, generally it is a short duration, and generally they present with the nausea, vomiting, anorexia, etc., and jaundice, and that will subside by itself. Okay. So, the chance of developing encephalopathy following hepatitis is very, very, very high. So, practically speaking, A is practically out. Can this be hepatitis B? Anybody else? Vishakha has said it is less likely. Why, Vishakha? You can answer.
Sir, hepatitis B, there is no acute cause for it to occur at this age because child has not received any blood transfusions. There is no history suggestive of needle stick injury or so. But it can be fulminant hepatitis C, which is also very less likely at this age.
Okay. So, as Vishakha said, I think the transmission of hepatitis B is, as you know, it is for blood transfusion or injections, like using needles, etc. But here, one more thing, it can be mother to baby. If it is mother to baby, but we are actually screening all the mothers for hepatitis B. And if the mother is positive, what will you do, Nida? If the mother is hepatitis B positive, what will you do?
Yeah. So immediately after birth, both hepatitis B vaccine and 0.5 ml of hepatitis HB. Immunoglobulin will also be given, sir, on two separate sites.
Okay. And then you will give vaccine also.
Yes, sir. Then we'll be giving vaccine.
So hepatitis B is unlikely, but still, there are certain situations where hepatitis B is seen in babies without any source. Okay, so you cannot practically 100% rule out hepatitis B here. And again, hepatitis B is one condition which can go for complications out of all this. Okay, so if that is hepatitis B, what are the other questions you should ask? Simple questions. Simple basic question that should be included in the presenting history. Anybody? Parathi? I think Parathi is only find your PG, I know.
Sir.
Where are the Joikim Parathi even? In other words, what are the extra hepatic manifest hepatitis B? Extra hepatic manifestation of hepatitis B, which should be included in the present history.
Pruritis
എന്താണ് യൂഷ്വലി എപ്പോഴാണ് വരുന്നത്? ഒബ്സ്ട്രക്റ്റീവ് ഫേസിലാണ്. യൂഷ്വലി കാണുന്നത് എന്താണ്? ഇറ്റ് ഈസ് ആർത്രാൽജിയ ആൻഡ് റാഷ് അല്ലെ? യൂഷ്വലി കാണുന്നത് ഇറ്റ് ഈസ് ആർത്ര യൂഷ്വലി ആസ്ക് ഫോർ ആർത്രാൽജിയ. വാട്ട് ഈസ് ആർത്രാൽജിയ? പെയിൻ ഓഫ് ദി ജോയിന്റ്സ് ആൻഡ് അഗൈൻ ഡെവലപ്മെന്റ് ഓഫ് റാഷ്. ഓക്കെ, അപ്പൊ അതാണ് യൂഷ്വലി. അപ്പൊ യൂഷ്വലി ഇൻക്ലൂഡ് ദീസ് ടു പോയിന്റ്സ് ആൾസോ ഇൻ ദി ലിസ്റ്റ്. വൺ മോർ തിങ് You should also ask for papilla acrodermatitis. What is this particular condition? Hepatitis B patient developing papilla acrodermatitis. What is it called? -- syndrome. Anybody? All these will fetch you additional marks for your exam. Papilla acrodermatitis occurring in hepatitis B is called? Starting with the GC syndrome. Clue that I'm GC syndrome. Anybody? It's called Gynotic Cross-T syndrome. Okay, Gynotic Cross-T syndrome. Okay, so it can be hepatitis also. And if it is hepatitis, more likely to be hepatitis B, because that is one thing which can go for cross. Okay. Any more infection we should think of being a treatable cause? Anyone? Can this be a liver abscess?
Yes, sir.
It can be a liver abscess. Why? See, child is classically presenting with a fever, decreased activity, abdominal distension. All this can occur. And again, liver abscess can present on this house. So, and what is the setting of a liver abscess? We know it is uncommon in children.
Okay.
But it can occur in children. It is not extremely rare. We don't know the status. Child may be immunocompromised. Who knows? It. And again, you should always ask for two settings. One, you should ask for evidence of omphalitis, any history of any umbilical infection, because umbilical omphalitis is one setting where it can lead on to liver abscess. So always ask for evidence of any other focus of infection or sepsis or omphalitis which can lead on to liver abscess. Okay. So I think that finishes the first list of causes in a baby who can present with cholestasis.
Okay,
you proceed. Then you said no history of any drug intake. Yes, so yes, what are the common drugs that can affect the liver, and what are the different types of DILI? What is DILI? Drug induced
liver injury.
What is DILI? DILI which endana rice
കോമൺ
സെൻസ് മതിയടേ പറഞ്ഞു Drug induced liver injury. Okay. So what are the common drugs that can affect the liver, and second, what are the mechanisms by which liver is affected?
Sir, one is paracetamol. Centrilobular necrosis. Then other drugs,
antitubercular. Okay, you can include all NSAIDs.
Antitubercular drugs, sir. Isoniazid.
Okay, antitubercular drugs.
Then.
That's the mechanism, Miranda. Mainly two mechanisms. That's what I'm saying.
Okay. Then, sir. Then antiepileptics like valproate, carbamazepine.
Valproate. So for basically NSAIDs, antiepileptics like valproate and phenytoin, pinne. Okay.
And then
erythromycin, alle, pinne. Cephalosporins, especially ceftriaxone. പിന്നെ നമ്മൾ ദ കോമൺ ഡ്രഗ്സ് ദാറ്റ് ഈസ് യൂസ്ഡ് ഇൻ പീഡിയാട്രിക്സ് അതിപ്പോ അത് പറഞ്ഞാൽ പിന്നെ എന്താണ് സ്റ്റീറോയിഡ്സ് പിന്നെ ഏറ്റവും കൂടുതൽ ചോദിക്കേണ്ടത് എന്താണ് ഹിസ്റ്ററി ഓഫ് ട്രീറ്റ്മെന്റ് വിത്ത് അതർ മെഡിസിൻസ് എസ്പെഷ്യലി ഹോമിയോ മെഡിസിൻസ് കാര്യം എന്താണ്
ഇറ്റ്സ്
നോട്ട് ദ സ്റ്റീറോയിഡ് അവര് കേട്ടോ അടിക്കും കേട്ടോ ഞാൻ അവർ സ്റ്റീറോയിഡ് കൊടുക്കാന്ന് പറഞ്ഞാൽ ബേസിക്കലി ദ ഹോമിയോ the source of homeo is either from Germany or from China. Okay. So they are basically German or Chinese herbal products. Okay. And both these German and Chinese herbal products can affect the liver. Okay. So these are the common drugs you should know. And the main two mechanisms are one is idiosyncratic and second is dose dependent. But there are two mechanisms. So idiosyncratic means what is you give a drug, patient develops liver toxicity. That is not dose dependent. And second is predictable or always got dose dependent, where the liver injury is dose dependent. So these are the basic two mechanisms by which liver is affected. And here, and what are the other symptoms of by which you can diagnose or suspect DILI? Along with fever and jaundice, child will also have.
There can be rash. No,
yeah, they can have rash, arthralgia, and myalgia. Okay, so any child with a jaundice, with a fever, rash, arthralgia, myalgia can have drug induced liver injury. So, in artham dana here, our next DD, first is DD is infection, and infection we already discussed. And second differential diagnosis dana is drug induced liver injury because child has received paracetamol, and did you specifically ask for? Treatment by a homeo, Ayurvedic or other herbal medicines?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
No, no. Yes, sir. Negative history. Okay. So that finishes the second course.
Okay.
Now, you said autoimmune problem. Can this be autoimmune?
Sir, it can be, but there is no history of any photosensitive rash or arthralgia.
What is in your mind when you see autoimmune disease manifesting in this time? Are you suspecting SLE? What some other?
Some autoimmune hepatitis.
Can this be autoimmune hepatitis?
Sir, it can present, sir.
Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Okay. So I think the next possibility can be autoimmune hepatitis. What are the points favor and part of the points against from your history? Should you think of something else or will you ask for any other question?
Yes, sir. I will ask for history of any oral ulcers.
No, autoimmune hepatitis will not cause oral ulcers. Yeah. That is in a set.
Nice.
But then another. Somebody has had a vaccine and meaning jaundice. I can occur. Pinandana. It can also cause arthritis and rash. Pinandana. It causes anemia. What type of anemia? It causes arthritis, rash, and Coombs negative hemolytic anemia. Mm-hmm. And is age a criteria in autoimmune hepatitis? Manateja? No, autoimmune hepatitis can occur in any age. Inside. So here, autoimmune hepatitis is a close differential diagnosis because it can occur at any age. It can cause fever. It can cause irritability, that is a malaise. It can cause rash and arthritis. It can also cause Coombs negative hemolytic. So autoimmune hepatitis also is a differential. Okay. Now we'll take up the next group of disorders that can present as gastritis, and that is a metabolic.
Yes, sir.
So what are the various metabolic conditions that can that should be suspected in this time?
Galactosemia.
Okay, somebody said Wilson. Okay, well, can this be Wilson?
Yeah. Less likely, sir, because age group is like 9 months only, sir. Wilson is.
Very good. I think that is answer. So, Wilson disease is one disease which is autosomal recessive, but that is extremely rare, less than
4 years. Sir.
4 years or 3 years. Okay, I think the world youngest Wilson is around 2 years. So, practically speaking, it is not Wilson disease because it usually do not manifest less than 3 years of age. Okay. So I think, but you said no history of psychiatric disorder. Adakka parayanda kaariyilla kaari endana? You are not entertained the possibility of a Wilson disease. Okay. But if the child is probably above 4 years or 5 years, you should have discussed all those family history of psychiatric disorder, neurological disorder, etc. Okay. And what are the various presentations of Wilson disease? Rise. The various forms by which Wilson disease can present.
Psychiatric manifestations, neuropsychiatric manifestations it can have.
No, in children. You are a pediatrician. You should talk of children, not of adults.
Hepatic manifestations like. Fever, jaundice.
Involuntary movement.
Anemia. Yes, sir. Carefree.
നിങ്ങൾ അറിയേണ്ടത് എന്താണ് വിൽസൺ ക്യാൻ പ്രസന്റ് ഇസ് എനി ഫോം ദേ ക്യാൻ പ്രസന്റ് എസ് ഇസ് ആക്സിഡന്റലി ഡിക്റ്റേറ്റഡ് ഹെപ്പറ്റോമെഗാലി ക്യാൻ പ്രസന്റ് എസ് അക്യൂട്ട് ഹെപ്പറ്റൈറ്റിസ് ക്യാൻ പ്രസന്റ് എസ് ക്രോണിക് ഹെപ്പറ്റൈറ്റിസ് ക്യാൻ പ്രസന്റ് എസ് സിറോസിസ് ഓക്കെ സോ എനി ചൈൽഡ് വിത്ത് എ ഹെപ്പറ്റോമെഗാലി എനി ചൈൽഡ് വിത്ത് ഹെപ്പറ്റൈറ്റിസ് എനി ചൈൽഡ് പ്രസന്റ് വിത്ത് ക്രോണിക് ഹെപ്പറ്റൈറ്റിസ് എനി ചൈൽഡ് പ്രസന്റ് സിറോസിസ് യു ഷുഡ് തിങ്ക് ഓഫ് വിൽസൺ ആൻഡ് റൂൾ ഓഫ് വിൽസൺ ഇഫ് ഇൻഡിക്കേറ്റ് That is a must because it is a 100% treatable cause. Okay, and you can save one family from Wilson. So again, unexplained psychiatric manifestation in the parents or relatives, unexplained seizure, unexplained abnormal movements in a child with the hepatomegaly, or unexplained seizures in adults. You should screen the family for Wilson. Kajandana, Wilson is there in our community, but we are not following up these families. That's the parents are not going to the whole family. That should be the motto, because the role of a pediatrician is to treat and heal the family. It is not to cure the disease, it is to heal the family as a whole. Okay. Because I repeat that, I stress that point. If you don't have a global vision, I think you will fail as a clinician. Okay, so we will talk about the whole family. Okay, so that is another aspect of life. We'll discuss it in another session. Okay, so it is practically, it is not Wilson because of the age. Anything else? Can this be simple Dubin-Johnson syndrome? What is Dubin-Johnson syndrome, Manitaja? What is Dubin-Johnson syndrome? And how does it present? Samayam bondum samayam. Namukle history la pagadi ayade ullu.
Conjugate
type paranjittundo. Is there any time limit? Time limit?
2 hours. Sir, I think it is 2 hours, sir.
Till nine, sir.
Okay. Now we have to hurry. Otherwise, we will not finish. Okay.
Dubin-Johnson is conjugate hyperbilirubinemia.
Okay, so it is a conjugate hyperbilirubinemia, and that again presents with abdominal pain, fatigue, and jaundice. So this child has got abdominal distension, this child has got irritability, which may be fatigue, may manifest irritability and jaundice, but fever is not a common. But fever may be unrelated. No, karyathilla. So we have Dubin-Johnson is a possibility here. Okay, other moments. Okay. Can this be anything else? Okay. You said metabolic. Now, can this be a metabolic condition, or what are the metabolic conditions that can present as jaundice?
The metabolic conditions like galactosemia, tyrosinemia, hereditary factors.
See, you should answer with the reference to this child.
Okay, sir.
Whenever you, in clinical presentation, we are always discussing with the reference to your child, not in general.
Okay, sir.
Anybody? I think the two conditions you should entertain is, one is mitochondrial disorder, and second is glycogen storage disorder. Okay. So, tyrosinemia, how do they present? They will not survive to this life without any treatment. So, either this can be a mitochondrial disorder or can be a glycogen storage disorder. Because glycogen storage disorder, some forms, they can present as jaundice and cirrhosis and liver cell failure. Okay. And again, mitochondrial also can form jaundice. But can this be a mitochondrial? Yes or no? What the point of Varanyali? Since I think we had to finish within 1 hour, I am just rushing.
Less likely, sir, because.
What the point? And then mitochondrial syndrome. Mitochondrial syndromes are multi systemic. Mitochondrial disorders affect almost all the system. Why? Mitochondria is present in almost all parts of our body except RBC. It can affect the nerve, it can affect the muscle, it can affect the heart. So mitochondrial disorder usually is a multi-system disorder. This child is not having any symptoms of a multi-system disorder. So practically mitochondrial disease is out, but you have to include in your differential diagnosis and you have to include that in your history.
Okay, sir.
Okay. And similarly, can this be a glycogen storage disorder? Yes or no? Anybody, Bharati?
Less likely, sir.
Eh? No, sir. Less likely.
Why?
It is like a bond.
So, again, almost all the glycogen storage disorder will have and then affection of two major system and then either muscular system or cardiac. You know, cardiac, and then Pompe's disease, glycogen storage type 2 present as Pompe's and then cardiomyopathy. Similarly, usually they will have muscle weakness. They can have hypotonia, they can have muscle weakness. Okay. So they will have development delay. So here you said development is absolutely normal.
Okay.
So, but you should, any child with a person with this feature, especially if the child has got development delay or hypotonia or some abnormality in the heart, you should think of a glycogen storage disorder.
Okay.
So, we have
fourth one.
Differential diagnosis, then it is metabolic, mainly glycogen storage disorder, mitochondria. So, what do we do? അപ്പൊ ഇവിടെ ഞാൻ പറയാം, നിങ്ങൾ പോയി നോക്കിയാൽ മതി. യു ഷുഡ് നോ വാട്ട് ആർ ദ ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻസ് ടു ബി ആസ്ക്ഡ് ഇൻ സച്ച് എ ചൈൽഡ് തിങ്കിങ് ഓഫ് എ മെറ്റബോളിക് ഡിസോർഡർ. ഓക്കെ, ലൈക്ക് ജോണ്ടിസ് വരാം, ഹൈപ്പർടോണിയ വരാം, ഡയലറ്റ് ഡിലേ വരാം, ഹൈപ്പോഗ്ലൈസീമിയ വരാം, അൺയൂഷ്വൽ ഓർഡർ വരാം, കാറ്ററാക്ട് വരാം. സോ ഓൾ ദീസ് പോയിന്റ്സ് ഷുഡ് ബി മെൻഷൻ. ഓക്കെ, സോ ദാറ്റ് ഈസ് ദ ഫോർത്ത്. നൗ വിൽ ഗോ ടു ദ, യു സെഡ് സംബഡി സെഡ് ലെപ്റ്റോസ്പൈറോസിസ്. Can this be leptospirosis, Nida?
Yes, sir.
Yes or no? Why?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Yes. Why?
Acute onset fever with jaundice. Sir.
Okay.
There is no history of history suggestive of any contact with rodents or playing in muddy water.
Okay. Any point against? See, you should know that leptospirosis. When we call a disease leptospirosis, that is present with a fever, headache, myalgia. Okay, just like dengue. Okay, when the child is having jaundice, what do you call that condition? It is Weill syndrome. The presence of jaundice, if it is leptospirosis, the presence of jaundice indicates the child is having Weill syndrome. And generally, Weill syndrome is hepatorenal syndrome. such a patient will almost always have
renal symptoms.
Renal symptoms or evidence of renal failure like hematuria or anuria, puffiness of the face, etc. Okay. Again, usually leptospirosis occurs in adults. Okay. So practically speaking, and usually they will also have bleeding manifestation secondary to thrombocytopenia. So since the child is not having any features of renal failure, since the child is not having bleeding manifest in the form of thrombocytopenia, and since the child is an infant and no contact with the contact water, etc., hepatorenal syndrome or leptospirosis is very, very, very unlikely. Okay. Okay, can this be anything else? Can this be Ray syndrome? Usually Ray syndrome also presents with the fever, irritability, abdominal distension, all these can occur.
But sir, no history suggestive of any drug intake like aspirin?
കാണുന്നില്ല നമുക്ക് ഇപ്പൊ റേ സിൻഡ്രോം. റേ സിൻഡ്രോം ഈസ് ആൾമോസ്റ്റ് ഓൾവേസ് അനിക്ടറി. അതാണ് നമ്മൾ മനസ്സിലാക്കേണ്ടത്. മനസ്സിലായില്ല? ഇറ്റ് വിൽ നോട്ട് കോസ് ഇക്ടറസ്. ഹിയർ ബേസിക്കലി ദ സെറം ബിൽഗ്ലോബിൻ വിൽ ബി നോർമൽ, വെറസ് ഓൺലി ദ എൻസൈംസ് ആർ എലിവേറ്റഡ്. സോ റേ സിൻഡ്രോം യൂഷ്വലി ആസ് യു സെഡ് വിൽ ബി പ്രസിപിറ്റേറ്റ് ഐദർ ബൈ വൈറൽ ഇൻഫെക്ഷൻ ഓർ ഡ്രഗ്സ് ലൈക് ആസ്പർ, വിച്ച് ഇസ് വെരി റെയർ. ബട്ട് യൂഷ്വലി ഇറ്റ് മാനിഫെസ്റ്റസ് ഹൈപ്പോഗ്ലൈസീമിയ, ഹൈപ്പർ അമോണീമിയ ആൻഡ് elevated liver enzymes. Bilirubin will be normal, child will be anicter.
Okay.
So it is not racing.
Okay.
Okay. Can this be non-alcoholic fatty liver disease?
Less likely, sir, because age group is only 9 months. It's more common in adolescent age group.
No, no. Is it like that? What's the age group of non-alcoholic fatty liver disease? It will not occur before adolescence? Non-alcoholic fatty liver disease can occur in children as young as 2 years of age. Appo otta point parayanda endana, usually that occurs in obesity. Obesity appo ningal endu cheyana case edukkumbum, you calculate the BMI and BMI nokkite endha, if the BMI is normal you can definitely say sir he is not obese. Usually non-alcoholic fatty liver disease occurs in obese children. He is not obese, so it is very, very unlikely, and again usually it did not cause beyond the size. So you don't agree with your TB tuberculosis?
It can be, sir, but less likely.
Okay. Anybody else? Anybody else? Hello? Ivide parayano veetil parayano
social issue.
I think you have to entertain the possibility of tuberculosis. And if it is tuberculosis, what type of tuberculosis, Bharati?
Disseminated
tuberculosis. Why? So here comes the next question. What is Waldron's timetable? Nida, what is Waldron's timetable? കേട്ടിട്ടുണ്ടോ?
Yes, sir.
കേട്ടിട്ടുണ്ട് സർ. ഇല്ലെന്നോ?
Yes, sir.
എന്താണത്? That's a time at which each tuberculosis get manifest. Like anybody? Bharati? Bharati, sir?
Bharati, yes, sir.
Okay, so that's a time, that's a roughly the time at which each type of tuberculosis manifests. Like primary complex, that can occur by 6 weeks, isn't it? Okay, then disseminated tuberculosis appears by around 6 to 9 months. Then tuberculosis meningitis again occurring by 1 year. So that's a timetable for TB. And lastly is a renal TB, which appears by around 3 to 4 years. I think you should know the Van Rans timetable. And here, this is a, you cannot rule out being a treatable cause. And if all other investments are negative, you had to evaluate this child for development of tuberculosis. So you have to think of it tuberculosis because it can present as acute form, they can present as fever, abdominal distension, and irritable. Okay. I think now will you take the socioeconomic history? Socioeconomic. Okay, we'll discuss this. And again, we'll discuss this. One is HLH, hemophagocytic. Okay. So I think you have to, because that also can present with fever, irritability, and jaundice.
Yes, sir.
Okay, socioeconomic. Do you want to ask any further questions here? See, mother is a positive woman, father is a businessman. That and other than they are having multiple contacts. So they can be a carrier. So this adds to your point that tuberculosis is a possibility in this child.
Okay, sir.
Who is looking after the child?
Grandmother, sir.
Grandmother. Is it a joint family or nuclear family?
Grandmother matra illa sir, extra it.
Amma matra. Amma is chumma undo. Is she a diabetic? All these are very important. Why? The grandmother may be asymptomatic. She may be a diabetic, isn't it? Okay. Diabetic persons are prone to have tuberculosis. So you should say whether it's a nuclear family, joint family, who's looking after the child, and whether grandmother is symptomatic or not in the form of cough or having measles or any other symptom. Okay. Antenatal history. Development number paranyu and in a history. Okay. She has taken iron and folic. How many iron and folic acid tablets should be given? As per India government, what's the India government recommendation?
100 days.
100 days. How many what's the strength of iron folic acid tablets?
Folic acid 500
micrograms. 500 micrograms.
What's the strength of iron tablets? What's the strength of folic acid?
500 iron, 500 micro, 500 milligram iron and 100 microgram folic acid.
It is 104. Either camera, see, all these are basic questions that will be asked. Okay, then you go for the exam. Okay. 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 And how much the mother is an illiterate. And you said they're coming from a very poor family. From where will they get this? From where will they get the iron and folic acid tablet? You're from Rajagiri, right? They cannot. Rajagiri, you're mad and you're mad.
Community health centers.
Okay, you refer to the other you sent to the Anganwadi, nearest Anganwadi through the ICDS program. Okay. So you should know what are the services of the ICDS. Okay, and you should know how much calorie and how much protein is supplementary nutrition is given for pregnant and lactating women from the ICDS. All these are very important. Okay. Okay, now we'll go to the examination.
Okay.
At the end of our discussion, this can be, it can be infection like urosepsis or typhoid or malaria. That is one thing. Okay, hepatitis B. Okay.
Drug induced.
It can be drug induced. Adutha da.
Autoimmune hepatitis.
Okay, can be autoimmune hepatitis. Naale.
Metabolic, like glycogen storage disorders.
Okay, metabolic. Anje.
Liver abscess.
It can be SLH. Alle. Okay, come down. Okay, now you go to the examination. I think we are short of time.
Okay.
So I think so. We'll limit our discussion.
Okay. So, sir, general examination.
Time. Don't worry, sir. You can continue. No problem.
Alla, umbo thoda mani paranjyo nda andu thum.
Alla. Adu. It is flexible. If it.
Okay.
You, sir.
Change. Okay. Right. Okay, we'll go for the examination. Then at the end, I think we'll have a discussion on the investigation and differential diagnosis. Once again, right?
Okay.
Go to the examination.
General examination. Baby sitting on mother's lap. He's lethargic, and in between he's becoming irritable. There is no pallor. Ictus was present.
Wait. We'll now get the another discuss here. Okay. Anybody wants to comment here? Do you want to qualify this Nida statement? But baby is in your mother's lap, lethargic and irritable. Nita, can you quantify this further?
He's sitting on mother's lap. He's not interested in surroundings.
No. Ippa namukku see, this is a subjective statement. Nita parayunnu irritable nu enikku irritable aayittu thonnilla. It is a subjective. Can you make this objective so that it can be applied by anyone? If you the night day at the night in your alley, if you can, I put you to blown at all. Matiak, neither irritability and the Matiak would irritability. So, can you make this? Yeah, very good. So, Vishaka said, so can so, as far as possible, you make it objective and then you make this, you score GCS here. Can you score GCS here for infants? Can you score GCS? Yes or no? What do you mean?
For infants.
What do? It is possible. It is possible. Okay. How? For example, ethron the GCS score at that. What's the GCS score?
Sir, GCS score. EVM, eye response, verbal response, and motor response.
Total, what is the total score?
15.
It is 15. Okay. And the main difference in the infants and all it is a verbal. Okay. Verbal and 5. Verbal number and the first and 5 if the child is falling night or if the child is smiling at you or the child is fixing.
Okay.
He has got consolable cry. Karey no rasha amma paalu allo amma aashwasipikkan nirthunnu consolable cry.
Okay.
It is 4.
Okay.
Third endana it is child is persistently irritable.
Okay.
Randa endana child is agitated or restless. Endu idalum bhayangara karachilum restless aanu. Idu onnum illa comatose aanengi onnu. So I think you modify this irritability into GCS. Okay.
Okay.
So that's my message. So as far as possible make subjective endakkanam. Objective.
Okay. Carry on. There is no history. There is no pallor. Ictus is present on the sclera, skin surface, arms, and soles. There is no cyanosis.
What's the best method to look for pallor? Nida? Best method to look for pallor? What's the black bleach or recommendation?
Best method. So on the palms. If the creases are not.
Puri kari mana parayana.
It is severe.
Anybody? What's the WHO recommendation for looking for pattern?
We'll compare with
examples. Yes, that's what I'm saying. If you have a compare your hand and compare. That is the WHO recommendation. Okay. Okay. You should not be anemic. Doctor is supposed to be a role model in the society. Okay. Okay. So always that is the WHO. Okay. See, carry on. So there is no pallor. Icterus is there. Then.
Yes, sir. Then no cyanosis, clubbing or edema. Then a small cervical lymph node of size 0.5 into 0.5 centimeter was palpable in the right cervical region, in the right posterior triangle, and lower one third of sternocleidomastoid, belonging to the posterior group, which was soft, non-tender, non-matted, which was mobile on horizontal and vertical plane, and skin over the node is normal. Then another lymph node of size 2 into 2 centimeter was palpable in the right axilla, which is central, firm, non-tender, non-matted, which was also mobile, and skin was normal.
Okay, so what is the comment here?
Comment is, sir, the axillary lymphadenopathy is significant, sir, since the size is more than 1 centimeter. Cervical is not significant.
So what's the, is generalized lymph node enlargement or localized lymph node enlargement? And tell me what is, and tell me what is significant generalized lymphadenopathy.
Generalized lymphadenopathy is when more than or equal to 2 non-contiguous lymph nodes are involved.
Okay, so when the more than 2 non-contiguous lymph nodes are involved, you call that a generalized lymph node enlargement. Okay, so what is a significant lymph node?
A significant lymph node is, sir, when if any of the epitrochlear lymph node is palpable, it is significant. If the axillary or cervical lymph node of size more than 1 centimeter, it is significant. If inguinal lymph node of size more than 1.5 centimeter, it is
significant. Very good. Okay, so that is 1 centimeter for cervical and axillary and 1.5 for inguinal. Okay, good. Okay, and is it common to have lymph node palpable in infants?
Yes, sir.
Can you palpate lymph nodes in newborns?
No, less common, sir.
Are the Sahil, Vishakha, and Selina, the classmates are not?
Sir, Vishakha classmate and sir, Serena madam.
Vishakha, what is her helper? Did they help me, Sahai?
No, sir. In you cannot palpate lymph nodes in infant.
Okay. So what is the time for lymphoid enlargement?
Lymphoid growth is
maximum?
1.5 to 2 years it begins, by 5 to 6 years maximum.
Okay, so that is the message. So generally, you cannot palpate lymph nodes in the newborns and also in infant. Usually, the lymph nodes become increased in size in toddlers after around 1 to 2 years and reaches the maximum size by 4 to 7 years, and then it comes down. Okay. So your comment is the child is having a significant axillary lymph node. LA. It is not a general lymph node because cervical lymph node is only 0.5, which is insignificant. And you have got a right axial lymph node, which is significant. Okay, carry on.
So next is vital, sir. His heart rate is 120 per minute, which is regular in rhythm, normal in cap and volume, no radial delay, all peripheral pulses equally. Then a BP 90/50 mmHg, which was measured in the right upper arm in lying position. Then saturation was 96%, respiratory rate 32 per minute, which was regular, abdominal thoracic. Temperature 100.8 degree Fahrenheit, which was measured in right axilla. CFT less than 2 seconds. GRB is 92 gram per deciliter.
Do you mention blood sugar along with vitals? It's a clinical examination.
Yes,
mention. Okay. Carry on. So what's the comment on the vitals?
Vitals, fever, other than that, all his vitals are stable.
Okay. Right. Can you?
Then, sir, anthropometry. His weight is 8 kilogram. His expected weight is 8.5 kilogram. His weight by expected weight into the percentage will be coming 94%. So according to IEP classification, it is more than 80%, so it is normal. And as per WHO growth chart, it is coming between 3rd and 50th centimeter. Then length is coming 70 centimeter. His expected length is 71 centimeter. According to Bartolo classification, it is normal because it is coming as 98%. More than 95% is normal according to Waterloo. Then as per WHO chart also, it is coming between the 3rd and 50th centimeter. Then weight by height, according to it's a 96%. There is no wasting. According to Waterloo classification, as per WHO growth chart, it is between the 3rd and 50th centimeter. Head circumference is 44 centimeter. It is at the 50th centimeter. Inferences.
What are coming on the growth?
There is an evidence of malnutrition or.
Okay, so child is not having any. What is acute malnutrition? What is chronic malnutrition?
In case of acute malnutrition, there can be wasting, but the height for age will be normal. There
no, acute malnutrition. What is the other one?
Weight for age will be.
So they'll have acute malnutrition. The weight for age will be less. When the child is chronically malnourished, what will happen?
Both weight for age and height for age will be
Length correct. Okay. So here length is also normal, weight is also normal. So there's no acute or chronic malnutrition. Okay. Yes, sir.
Then sir, head to foot examination. Mm-hmm. His head appears normal in shape. There was some hair was a bit hyperpigmented. AF is open, 1.52 centimeter. Then there is no dysmorphic facies, no frontal bossing. Ear and nose appeared normal. Eyes, there was no pallor, but ictus present. And then there was no evidence of deficiency like white or spots or dryness of conjunctiva or cornea. His fundus was normal. His oral cavity was normal. There was no bleeding or there was no history. There is no fetal hepaticus. There is no evidence of vitamin deficiency like angular keratitis, stomatitis, or gingivitis. Skin appeared normal. No distended veins. No scratch marks. No rash, petechiae, purpurae, ecchymosis, or spider weaving. There was no palmar erythema. Nails was appearing normal. Spine and vertebra normal.
Okay. So from this head to foot examination, which are diseases you can rule out? We discussed a lot of differential diagnosis from the history. Here we are examining the child and we are ruling out one by one. In this head to foot examination, what are the diseases that can be practically ruled out? Sometimes we may be wrong, but it can be based on these findings, you can. Next slide. You can practically rule out many illness here. And the gap.
Okay.
First is an answer.
There is no dysmorphism.
So that means you rule out what?
Metabolic disorders. Glycogen storage disorders.
Okay. So what's the classical percentage of a glycogen? What's the classical facies described? Coarse facies apply the mucopolysaccharides again. So here you have a doll facies. So dysmorphism is practically this child is unlikely to be metabolic. In the eyes, what will you look for in a metabolic disorder?
We can look for cataract.
You look for cataract. Cataract is usually is not rare in metabolism. So you have to look for cataract and you have to control over that. Then you have said there is no bleeding, fetal hepaticus. What does that indicate?
Yes, sir. There is no history of liver failure, sir.
So practically, liver is not in a decompensated state.
Then
you said no scratch marks. Why?
For pruritus, sir.
What is in your mind when
conjugated hyperbilirubinemia can cause a pruritus.
It is not causing obstruction. How does it cause? You get scratched with pruritus when there is obstructive jaundice. When will you have obstructive jaundice? When something is obstructing on the biliary tract. So you can think of what is the commonest cause of obstruction in the biliary tract?
In neonates, this extra.
No, you're talking of this 9 month old.
Sir. In this case, any infection causing sclerosis.
Like what? Anybody? Somebody said Bacchieri. Can this be Bacchieri? I'm not that important, lello. Okay. Can this be Bacchieri? What is Bacchieri? Are you type in
there? Bacchieri. Bacchieri.
Amaka. Abdul chance or go. Ruben. Okay. Ruben. Just tell me something about Bacchieri. You're right. You should always think of Bacchieri whenever you come across a child with jaundice. And as you said, that child can present the baby manifestation also, and it can occur at any age also. But in such a case, normally history rendu nerunda parayanamayirunnu. What is Bacchieri and what are additional points you should mention in the history if this is Bacchieri?
Bacchieri means it will be acute occlusion of hepatic vein or
suprahepatic. Okay, so it is obstruction of the hepatic vein. Okay, right, good. Then
it can be usually.
And they manifest as you rightly said, they can manifest as jaundice and bleeding manifestation. That is also right. Okay. Angane anangale, what are the precipitating factors for Bacchieri?
Any procoagulable states.
Very good. That is it. Understand it. So, apo history ningal endoda kootanamayirunnu. You should always ask for a hypercoagulable state. Alle, in the family. So, what are the evidence of hypercoagulable state in the family? Variant manifestation.
Any history of stroke.
Yeah. So, young stroke. Very stroke alle. You should ask for young stroke. You should ask for sudden death. You should ask for young ischemic heart disease. ഇതാണ് മനസ്സിലായില്ലേ സോ അപ്പോൾ യങ് സ്ട്രോക്ക് സഡൻ ഡെത്ത് പിന്നെ എന്താണ് ഇസ്കീമിക് ഹാർട്ട് ഈ മൂന്ന് ഇസ്കീമിക് ഹാർട്ട് ഡിസീസ് സോ അത് രണ്ടും ചോദിക്കുക പിന്നെ എന്താണ് രണ്ടാമത്തെ എന്താ നോക്കേണ്ടത് ബച്ചീരി ക്യാൻ ആൾസോ ബി പ്രെസിപിറ്റേറ്റഡ് ഫോളോയിങ് ഇൻഫെക്ഷൻ നമ്മൾ നേരത്തെ പറഞ്ഞില്ലേ യൂറോ സെപ്സിസ് ഗ്രാമിനേറ്റീവ് സെപ്സിസ് അതൊക്കെ എന്താ ഉണ്ടാക്കാം ബച്ചേരി പ്രെസിപിറ്റേറ്റ് ചെയ്യാം മൂന്നാമത്തെ എന്താണ് വാട്സ് ദ തേർഡ് പോയിന്റ് ടു ബി മെൻഷൻ
എനി കൈൻഡ് ഓഫ് അദർ ഒബ്സ്ട്രക്ഷൻസ്
അല്ല ട്രോമ trauma to the abdomen. So, upon you should always, appo ee moonu karyam undu nammude history parayanavarunnu. No history of trauma to the abdomen. Pin endana his no family history il endu parayanam you should always mention a hypercoagulable state in the family. Oru karyam kode.
Okay.
Other than Bacchieri, sinusoidal obstruction is more common in children than Bacchieri. Mansaliye hepatic vein obstruction ekkattle sinusoidal obstruction is more common and that is again precipitated by endana herbal remedies nammal nerthe valla homeo so homeo medicines especially German and Chinese herbal medicines can cause Bacchieri because these are herbal remedies that precipitates obstruction in the sinus
okay
okay and another group of children who can develop Bacchieri is children receiving cytotoxic drugs
System examination, abdomen examination. First on inspection, abdomen appears mildly distended, flanks appears full, all quadrants moves equally with respiration, no visible veins, pulsations, or no visible peristalsis, or no visible mass. There is no scars or sinuses. Umbilicus appears normal, which is flushed with the surface. Hernal orifices appears free. External genitalia normal.
Okay.
The next is palpation. There is no local rise of temperature. There is no tenderness. Liver is palpable 4 cm below the right costal margin. Liver span is 9 cm. Liver is non-tender, non-pulsatile, smooth surface, which is firm in consistency with sharp borders, no hepatic rub. Spleen is palpable 5 cm below the left costal margin and which is extending towards right ilia fossa, which is non-bilotable and not able to get above the swelling, which is non-tender, a smooth surface, a firm in consistency with sharp borders. I didn't feel the splenic notch. Then no other organs or mass were palpable. Then percussion, there is no fluid thrill. All the areas of abdomen were resonant, so no shifting dullness. Auscultation, bowel sounds were heard normally. Then there is no hepatic bruit or there is no venous hum. Then other system examination, central nervous system, his higher mental function, he was lethargic. His cranial nerves were normal. His motor system power, he was moving all four limbs. His tone was appearing normal. Bulk, it was normal. All his superficial dependent reflexes were present, which was not exaggerated. Bilateral plantar was flexor. Sensory system, he was able to appreciate pain. Other sensations I couldn't check. Cerebellar sense also, there was no nystagmus or titubation. Spine and cranium, normal. Then other systems, respiratory system and CVS system are normal. There is inspection trochoapia center, shape of the chest was normal, chest was symmetrically moving with respiration. There was no fullness or flattening of intercostal space. Apical impulse was seen at the left to fourth intercostal space, admittal clavicular line. Palpation, trochea position was confirmed. Apical impulse was also felt at left fourth intercostal space. Percussion, all line fields were resonant. Liver dullness was felt at left right fifth intercostal space. Auscultation, the sounds were heard equally bilaterally and there were no added sounds. Central nervous CVS examination was also normal in this type. On inspection, shape and symmetry of the chest was normal. There were no precordial bulge, no engorged veins or pulsation. Apical impulse was seen at left fourth intercostal space. Then palpation, apical impulse felt at left fourth intercostal space at midclavicular line. There was no thrill or palpable P2, no parasternal heave. Auscultation, S1, S2 was heard, no murmur. Percussion, no evidence of cardiomegaly.
So summarize your findings. This history I'm going to discuss here. From the findings, you just summarize your important positive and negative findings.
Positive findings on examination: he is febrile, he has icterus, he has firm hepatosplenomegaly. Then there is no evidence of ascites or.
Okay. So these are your differential diagnosis. At the end of, do you want to after this at the end of discussion, do you want to modify this? Do you want to add something or do you want to delete something? Then we will discuss one by one.
Yes, sir. I want to add and I
want. I'll to do one thing. This. Just like at the end of history, we took 1 minute. So similarly, all of you take in 1 minute and you can write down your own differential diagnosis in the order. And then we'll have a discussion on the differential diagnosis and then the investigation management.
Okay.
Again, depending upon our time.
Sir, time is up to you, sir. So don't.
Okay. Thank you. അല്ല പിള്ളേർക്ക് ബോറടിക്കും അത് പറഞ്ഞൂടല്ലോ
നോർമലി ഒരു 2 hours ഒക്കെ ഉണ്ടാവില്ലേ
അതെ യൂഷ്വലി കാണണം ഒക്കെ പോകും സാർ എന്നാലേ ഒരു പി ജി ഡിസ്കഷൻ കംപ്ലീറ്റ് ആകത്തുള്ളൂ എന്നുള്ളതാണ്
സാറ് തീരുമാനിച്ചാ മതി
ശരി ഓക്കെ താങ്ക് യു
First
you said you had written as acute hepatitis, secondary to sepsis.
Yes, sir.
What do you mean hepatitis?
You define inflammation of the hepatocytes.
When you say hepatitis, what is coming into your mind is viral hepatitis.
Okay.
Like,
yes, sir.
Will you call jaundice caused by dengue as a dengue hepatitis? Will you call jaundice occurring malaria as malaria hepatitis? No.
Yeah.
So when you say hepatitis, that means it is viral hepatitis. And what is viral hepatitis? It is hepatitis caused by?
ABCD.
Caused by? Dash virus. And the virus are?
Hepatitis.
Hepatotropic. So that is very, very important. You never say like this. And then acute hepatitis, secondary sepsis, for a part. When you say acute hepatitis, we have to say that. Viral hepatitis. That means hepatitis caused by hepatotropic virus. Otherwise, if you want to say it is secondary to sepsis, you can say jaundice secondary to sepsis. Okay. First, you can say differential diagnosis. Hepatitis is caused by hepatotropic virus, that is A, B, C, D, E, F.
Okay.
So what is your first DD at the end of history and examination? History, we discussed detailed discussion. Examination, we discussed child is having no dysmorphism. I will just sum up. No dysmorphism. Child is having stable vitals. That means child is not in shock. TSC is almost full except for irritability. Child is having a significant axillary lymph node enlargement with firm hepatosplenomegaly and no ascites. That is the findings. And all other systems are normal. That is, they have a normal development, no malnutrition, no stunting, no wasting.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, what is your first possibility, second possibility, third possibility? That is your question. This is only for discussion. It's a clinical discussion.
First it could be a simple viral hepatitis due to hepatitis A, B, C, D or virus, sir.
Okay, you think of a acute viral hepatitis. Anybody against? Anybody for? Or if 10 BGs on the tire, Minda, then the moisture, and then they can take it out. You think of a viral hepatitis.
Yes, sir.
What are your points in favor?
Sir, in favor because there is a acute onset fever with jaundice. On examination, there is firm epidermegaly is there. There is no other dysmorphism.
See, when you say acute viral hepatitis, that means
Child
is an acute infection of a short duration. But I'm going to say that means you are right. But in such a child, usually we have jaundice, submerged. But usually, that such a viral hepatitis will not cause a firm hepatomegaly. Usually, the child will have a soft liver with a smooth surface and rounded margin. A child with a significant hepatomegaly with a firm liver and a sharp body is against your viral hepatitis. That is one thing. And usually, splenomegaly will not be there. So, splenomegaly indicates usually, sometimes in hepatitis B can occur, but in all other things, infection, splenomegaly will not occur. Again, your child is irritable. But that can be explained by the pain because of the stretching of the liver capsule causing pain. That can be explained. So, I am against your acute viral hepatitis because of two reasons. One, you are having it is a firm hepatomegaly with a sharp border and a firm surface and a splenomegaly. So, these two points is against your acute hepatitis.
Yes.
Okay. Then, and again, I will say splenomegaly is secondary to your aorta hypertension.
Okay.
Splenomegaly can occur. What are the other evidence of aorta hypertension?
Sir, this is firm splenomegaly. Then,
but. This is the history.
No history of dilated veins or hematemesis.
Dilated veins agathu varumba endha sambhavikkunne when there are dilated veins inside the abdomen evada varunathu common site evada esophageal varices alle esophageal varices bleeding engena manifest cheynathu
hematemesis
and
malina
appo kissil ningal endu cheyanavarunnu you should have include malina മനസ്സിലായില്ലയോ ബ്ലഡ് ഇൻ സ്യൂട്സിന്റെ കൂടെ തന്നെ നോസി ഓഫ് മലീന എന്ന് പറയില്ല ഡാർക്ക് കളേഴ്സ് സ്യൂട്സ് പറയണം ഓക്കെ ഓക്കെ സർ ശരി ഓക്കെ സോ ഐ വിൽ നോട്ട് എന്റർടൈൻ യുവർ അക്യൂട്ട് ഹെപ്പറ്റൈസ് ദി ഫസ്റ്റ് പാസ് ഓക്കെ സർ
അപ്പോൾ
എന്ത് അടുത്തത്
അതെ സർ സിൻസ് ദേർ ഈസ് എ ഹിസ്റ്ററി ഓഫ് പാരസിറ്റമോൾ ഇൻടേക്ക് ദേർ ഈസ് എ പോസിബിലിറ്റി ഓഫ് ഡ്രഗ് ഇൻഡ്യൂസ് ഹെപ്പറ്റൈറ്റിസ് ബട്ട്
manifest?
In secondary HLH, it can have present with fever, splenomegaly. Child can be toxic.
Pinne.
It's lymphadenopathies.
Pinne. See, HLH, there are two types, primary and?
Secondary.
LA. Yes, and again, primary is usually seen in infants.
Yes,
and secondary is usually secondary to infection. But usually that is seen in porcelain valuable like anonymous. That is one thing. Okay. So, infant sample, like it is usually more entertaining is the primary HLH. And they will have, there will be more toxic. They will have, what is the criteria? There's a criteria for HLH. But each of the budget to one. Okay. And usually they will have. They can have jaundice, and by the time they can have jaundice, they will also have a significant hepatosplenomegaly and significant generalized lymph node enlargement. And also, they can have varied systemic manifestation like respiratory distress, rash, and also by cytopenia. Sometimes also bleeding manifestation. And you go by the criteria for HLH. Ariyalo, how many criteria should be there?
Criteria. As a total, more than or equal to 5 criteria.
Okay. 5 out of 8 criteria.
Yes.
Then you will see another fever on the splenomegaly on the. But usually they will get 2 cell lines involved. Usually they will get thrombocytopenias also. Usually they will have anemia. So when the bleeding manifestation, Maria, and usually they will by the time they are beyond this, they will also have generalized infront enlargement as well as. So, but I will not. Rule out HLH, but HLH cannot be included as a first possible. One, it is very rare. Second, we should always consider curable causes first. Be optimistic. Common things are common. Common things are common. First, you entertain completely curable causes. First, urosepsis. Urosepsis can take the form of fever.
Okay,
as a part of sepsis, it can cause hepatosplenomegaly. It can smooth down enlargement. And irritability can be explained by cystitis. And the pain would vary. Okay. So I think still being a treatable cause, I will consider treatable causes like urosepsis and enteric fever as the first differential diagnosis. Urosepsis, because it is 100% treatable. Being a male child, we have no chance for the urinary stream. We don't know other factors like constipation, and it is a treatable 100% curable cause. So, and can cause hepatosplenomegaly also, and also jaundice. Okay. So, I will still consider urosepsis first. Second, and then I will definitely rule out enteric and malaria by they are also 100% treatable. They can also present in the form of fever, irritability, jaundice, and hyperuricemia.
Okay.
Okay. Okay. I will always think of tuberculosis. Okay. Mother is a forced woman.
Okay.
Father is a businessman, so they have got so many contacts.
Okay.
And child is in the 9 months, that is a classical presentation of disseminated tuberculosis.
Okay.
And child has also got a significant axillary node with a capillary myocarditis. So all these are can be explained in disseminated tuberculosis.
Okay.
And how will you explain the jaundice in disseminated tuberculosis?
Any nodes compressing over the
So a node compressing upon the biliary system and it can cause jaundice. So being a treatable cause and being an employed parents, I will rule out, provided and then all these are first investigation are negative.
Okay.
I'll think of tuberculosis also as a prostitute.
Okay.
Okay. Definitely being a child with jaundice, you have to think of all forms of hepatitis from A to E, but A is unlikely because hepatitis A presenting with the hepatosplenomegaly is unlikely.
Okay.
But still, I will rule out because sometimes it can be chronic relapsing hepatitis, which is a rare form of hepatitis A, which can present as chronic hepatitis with splenomegaly.
Okay.
Okay. So I will evaluate for hepatitis A, B, and C.
Okay.
But that is not acute, but probably going for chronic hepatitis with sometimes early features of encephalopathy. By in such a child, irritability should be taken as a evidence of early encephalopathy.
Okay.
And say.
Okay.
Arthi endana. Then you should think of autoimmune hepatitis. Autoimmune hepatitis can present at any age and can classically present with fever, jaundice, and irritability. So autoimmune and it can also cause pneumonia. So autoimmune hepatitis is a possibility.
Okay.
Next, then comes the your HLH. Okay. HLH can be considered then.
Okay.
Then you said hematological malignancy. Can this be hematological malignancy?
Is there any metastasis to liver?
What are the hematological malignancy you know?
As a hematological malignancy like leukemia, lymphoma.
Okay. How do they manifest?
It can manifest with acute onset fever, lymphadenopathy.
Can cause fever.
Lymphadenopathy, hepatosplenomegaly can cause.
Okay,
then jaundice could be probably like any nodes, as we have already told, obstructing the portohepatitis.
Okay. Now, point against Sandana, a child with this much amount of hepatosplenomegaly causing enlarged node pressing upon the biliary tract will almost always have generalized lymphoma. Child with if it is hematological malignancy, this much of hepatosplenomegaly they'll almost always have a generalized cervical axillary lymph node and lymph node enlargement. And usually that child also will have bone marrow involved. Child will have anemia. They will have bone pain. They'll have significant pallor. They'll have severe prostration. And say, if you don't know, hepatosplenomegaly mathrum, or axillary lymph node mathrum, without pallor, hematological malignancy viral chances is very, very
less.
But that is down in the list.
Okay.
So I think we'll put hematological malignancy down in the list.
Okay.
And finally, I think, as you said, we can consider Burchiari, but practically that is out. Kaidian, the Burchiari usually also causes on the there is a bleeding manifestation, illa, jaundice, illa, hypercalcemia, trauma, illa, but that is also done.
Okay.
And again, you should always think of any child coming to you with a hepatosplenomegaly with the jaundice and irritability, you should think of histiocytosis. Especially Langerhans-Hell histiocytosis is a variety which can present any form. But they can present with jaundice, they can present with the hepatosplenomegaly, they can present with irritability.
Okay.
മനസ്സിലായില്ലേ? ബട്ട് അഗെയിൻ ദാറ്റ് ഷുഡ് ബി ഡൗൺ ഇൻ ദി ലിസ്റ്റ്. അപ്പൊ നിങ്ങൾ, സോ ഐ തിങ്ക് ഇഫ് യു റീഅറേഞ്ച് യുവർ ഡിഫറൻഷ്യൽ ഡയഗ്നോസിസ്, ഇറ്റ് ക്യാൻ ബി ഇൻഫെക്ഷൻ ലൈക് യൂറോസെപ്സിസ്, ടൈഫോയിഡ് ആൻഡ് മലേറിയ, പിന്നെന്താണ് ക്രോണിക് കണ്ടീഷൻ ലൈക് ട്യൂബർക്കുലോസിസ്, ദെൻ വൈറൽ ഹെപ്പറ്റൈറ്റിസ്, ഓട്ടോഇമ്മ്യൂൺ ഹെപ്പറ്റൈറ്റിസ്, HLH can be primary or secondary.
Okay, sir.
Then histiocytosis, Bertiari, and lastly,
Camelotic
okay. Hepatitis. Okay. I think this should be the order. And metabolic practically we are ruled out because his development is completely normal.
Okay.
Now, I'll ask one or two questions. Okay. Can this be alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency? Anybody? How does it present? It can cause jaundice.
Yes, it can cause, but lung problem.
Pulmonary involvement can be there.
Hello?
Usually there can be lung involvement also associated with jaundice.
Alpha-1-antitrypsin deficiency can take any form. They can present as jaundice. Pulmonary manifestation may not occur. Appo usually nammal choikkanda endana family history is very important. Why? There's an 80% recurrence in the family. Means appo family history of endana jaundice or family history of emphysema angle ellam undengile you should think of alpha antitrypsin deficiency associated. Adhaan importance. Means appo and again it can also cause hepatosplenomegaly even though splenomegaly is not there. Okay. Pinne can this be a cystic fibrosis? നമ്മൾ പലപ്പോഴും മൾട്ടിസിസ്റ്റം ഡിസോർഡർ പറയുന്നതാണ്, ജോണ്ടിസ് വരാം, ന്യൂമോണിയ വരാം, മെക്കോണിയിലിസ് വരാം എന്നൊക്കെ പറയാറില്ലേ.
Can
this be cystic fibrosis?
Yes, it can be, sir, but other features of cystic fibrosis are absent in this. Also, it's an acute onset.
It's unlikely. എന്താ അൺലൈക്കിൽ ഞാൻ പറയാൻ കാര്യം? നിങ്ങൾ അൺലൈക്കിൽ തന്നെ പറയണം കാര്യം എന്താണ്? So you should know the presentation of cystic fibrosis in various ages. Cystic fibrosis newborn again manifests in the manifests meconium ages. Usually they develop jaundice and cirrhosis by around 10 years, not before that. So you should say cirrhosis and cystic fibrosis newborn ഞാൻ പറയാൻ എന്താണ്, യു ഷുഡ് നോ വാട്ട് ആർ ദ ഇൻഹെറിറ്റബിൾ കോസസ് ഓഫ് ജോണ്ടിസ് പ്രസന്റിംഗ് ലൈക്ക് ദിസ്. ദാറ്റ് ഈസ് വെരി വെരി ഇമ്പോർട്ടന്റ്. മനസ്സിലായില്ലേ? അപ്പം നമ്മൾ നേരത്തെ ഡിസ്കസ് ബിവിൾ വി ഡിസൈഡ് ഡൂബിൻ ജോൺസൺ, വി ഡിസ്കസ്ഡ് വിൽസൺ ഡിസീസ്, വി ഡിസ്കസ്ഡ് വേറെ എന്തൊക്കെയാ പറഞ്ഞത്, മറ്റേ ഓട്ടോസോമൽ റിസസീവ് കണ്ടീഷൻ ലൈക്ക് വിൽസൺ എക്സെട്ര അല്ലേ, സോ ഗ്ലൈക്കൻസ് ഓർ ഡിസോർഡർ. അപ്പൊ അന്നത്തെ പറയാൻ വിട്ടുപോയ രണ്ടു മൂന്നും കാര്യങ്ങൾ, ഒന്ന് സിസ്റ്റിക് ഫൈബ്രോസ് ആണ്, വേർ യൂഷ്വലി ദേ കോസ് സിറോസിസ് ബൈ 10 ഇയേഴ്സ്. പിന്നെ ആൽഫ 1 ആന്റിട്രിപ്സിൻ ഡെഫിഷ്യൻസി വേർ ഇൻഹെറിറ്റൻസ് ഈസ് അറൌണ്ട് 80%. പിന്നെന്താണ്, ദേ ഇസ് വൺ കണ്ടീഷൻ ദാറ്റ് ഇസ് റെയർ ബട്ട് യു ഷുഡ് നോ ഇറ്റ് ആസ് എ പോസ്റ്റ് ഗ്രാജുവേറ്റ് സ്റ്റഡി, ദാറ്റ് ഇസ് ന്യൂനേറ്റൽ അയൺ സ്റ്റോറേജ് ഡിസോർഡർ, ദാറ്റ് ഇസ് NISD. ഹൗ ഡസ് ഇറ്റ് മാനിഫെസ്റ്റ്, ന്യൂനേറ്റൽ അയൺ സ്റ്റോറേജ് ഡിസോർഡർ?
Severe
It causes rapidly progressive disease with a hepatomegaly, jaundice, hypoglycemia, bleeding manifestation. Even suppose he had hypoglycemia or suppose he had bleeding manifestation, you should have entertained the possibility of a neonatal and sorry disorder. For just discussion arrangement parnjam. Okay. അറിയണം. യു സെഡ് നോ ഇഷ്യൂ ഓഫ് ഹീമോളൈസിസ് ഓർ ബ്ലഡ് ട്രാൻസ്ഫ്യൂഷൻ. ദാ വാട്ട് ഇസ് വാട്ട് വാസ് ഇൻ യുവർ മൈൻഡ്?
സപ്പോസ്
ദേ ആർ കമ്മിങ് ഫ്രം നോർത്ത് ഇന്ത്യ, എക്സാമ്പിൾ പറയാണ്, യു ആർ ഗിവിങ് ഹീസ് ഗിവിങ് എ ക്ലൂ, ദേ ആർ കമ്മിങ് ഫ്രം നോർത്ത് ഇന്ത്യ എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞ ഒരു ക്ലൂ തന്നാല് വാട്ട് ഇസ് ഇൻ യുവർ
മൈൻഡ്?
തലസീമിയ പ്രസന്റ് ആസ് ജോണ്ടിസ് വരാം, പക്ഷേ നോട്ട് അറ്റ് നൈറ്റ്.
Okay, sir.
Sickle cell crisis. Sickle cell crisis. That's the idea. So, sickle cell hepatic crisis can present like this. Because of the pain. So sickle cell hepatic crisis can manifest exile in this way. അതുകൊണ്ടാണ് നോർത്ത് ഇന്ത്യ യൂഷ്വലി അവിടെ കാണുന്നത് ആസാമി സാമൊക്കെ ഈ കൺസാൻഡ് മാരി വന്നിട്ട് എന്ത് വെച്ചും സിക്കൽ സെൽ അനീമിയസ് കോമൺ. ഓക്കെ, അപ്പൊ ഇത് ഈ രണ്ട് കാര്യങ്ങൾ കൂടെ ഇൻക്ലൂഡ്. ഓക്കെ, സോ ദാറ്റ് ഈസ് അവർ ഡിഫറൻഷ്യൽ ഡയഗ്നോസിസ്. നൗ യു ക്യാൻ ജസ്റ്റ് ടെൽ മീ ദ ഇമ്പോർട്ടൻറ്റ് ഇൻവെസ്റ്റ് യു ഡു ആൻഡ് ദ ട്രീറ്റ്മെന്റ്. ഓക്കെ, രണ്ട് പറഞ്ഞ ഒരു അഞ്ച്
യൂറോസെപ്സിസ്. So we'll be doing first a complete blood count. Inflammatory markers like CRP, SR, we'll go for blood culture, urine culture. Then since the child presented with fever and jaundice, we'll also be more interested in doing LFT. Then including GGT and ALP.
Okay. Then how do you interpret LFT here?
In case of it will be conjugated hyperbilirubinemia can be there. Then
hyperbilirubinemia,
then
one more important thing, one more very basic but that is very important. You said you will do SGOT and SGPT.
Yes, sir.
AST and ALT.
Yes, sir.
So that is a clue.
It can be elevated, sir. It's an acute liver disease.
Can you call anybody else? Bharati? Why am I asking that question?
The rise transaminases will be there.
Yeah, both in all these conditions, the liver enzymes will be elevated. But the important point is that the source of SGPT is from the liver alone. Understand? So in viral hepatitis, what happens? Viral hepatitis is caused by hepatotrophic virus. So here, SGPT will be much more elevated than SGOT. Okay. Whereas in all other conditions, whether it is dengue or enteric or urosepsis or malaria or TB, what will happen? Okay. SGOT comes from other sources like liver, muscle, RBs, etc. So SGOT is more elevated.
Okay.
So if we get a condition where SGPT is more elevated than SGOT, it is more likely to be viral hepatitis. Whereas SGOT is more rare than SGPT, it is more likely to be infection in the liver caused by some other virus other than hepatotrophic virus. Okay, so I think that is very important. So that's very important here. Okay, so you should have based on LFT, you can do an alkaline phosphatase.
Okay.
And as you said, usually send a urine culture and also blood culture. And total count will be much elevated.
Okay.
And what antibody will you give if it is urosepsis?
Depends on the culture and sensitivity.
So we will wait for, when will you get the culture? If suppose you are in the cash where you are getting?
48 hours.
You will wait for 48 hours.
Okay. No, sir, we will start empirical, on empirical antibiotics.
Here's antibiotic.
Third generation cephalosporins.
No, be specific. You cannot say, I will give third generation cephalosporin.
Ceftriaxone, we can start.
What's the problem with ceftriaxone?
Here biliary sludge, it can
cause. Already you are jaundice on top.
It can aggravate.
It can cause biliary sludge. But cefotaxime is a good choice. By the way, the cefotaxime will not cause that much of cefotaxime. But or as somebody has here said, you can go for aminoglycosyl like amikacin.
Okay.
So I will personally go for cefotaxime because cefotaxime generally practically will not cause biliary cell, but not ceftriaxone. But those are two reasons. One, can cause biliary cell. Second, ceftriaxone is reserved for meningitis. Please reserve ceftriaxone for meningitis.
Okay.
So I'll check the send for culture and put the child on cefotaxime, or you can also give amikacin. So that is regarding urosepsis and manage accordingly. If it is typhoid, what will you do? For typhoid, what will you do?
Typhoid, if the fever is of less than 5 days duration, we can go for viral.
Your child is having 7 days fever. So 7 days is less fever.
Yes, sir.
Abhi endi.
blood culture. Sir, blood culture.
You should know how to interpret the total count and lymphocyte count. In typhoid, what will happen? Usually, in adults, it is leukopenia and lymphocytosis.
Okay.
In children, it can be leukocytosis, but there is significant lymphocytosis and eosinopenia. Eosinophils will be 0 or 1% in typhoid.
Okay.
Practically speaking, if you know the from the baseline blood count itself, you can interpret the differential diagnosis. So in typhoid fever, you will have a leukocytosis with the lymphocytosis and eosinopenia.
Okay,
and then it is a 7th day, and you know for the first week it is blood culture, and for second week it is a vital. So it is a 7th day, so you should send a blood culture, but chance of getting positive blood culture is less.
Okay.
Because we are in the borderline.
Okay.
But never send the vital today. Carry on the wait for 2 or 3 days.
Okay.
Carry on the blood vital negative. So send for blood culture, and if the child is stable, as somebody said, you can start the child on cefixim, which is oral, but it should be double the dose. Dose of cefixim in enteric fever is
20
milligram per kg per day. Usually it is 10 mg, so it is double the dose. But the child is sick, you can go for. What's the first line of drug?
Actually, ceftriaxone, sir.
Either you can go for, if you are bold enough, you can go for chloromycetine, or you can go for azithromycin, or you can go for ribosamine.
Okay.
Chloromycetine, azithromycin, or ribosamine.
Okay.
Please reserve ceftriaxone. Ceftriaxone is not as, but it is considered the second line drug, and the third line is drug is ciprofloxacin. Okay. So that is regarding entering. For if you are suspecting malaria, what will you do?
We can peripheral smear. We can do, sir. Total count.
You qualify the peripheral. Qualify the peripheral smear.
We can see the parasites. Different stages of parasites.
How many types of smear will you prepare?
Two types, sir. Thick and.
So you should make a. You should make a thick smear, you should make a thin smear. Thick smear and then a thin smear. Okay. Thick smear is to know the species, and thin smear is to
count.
Know the parasitemic index. You should know what is parasitemic index and all. Okay. And how many fields should we look for, and when will you call that as a negative smear? All these are important. Because of lack of time, I am not discussing that. Okay. So you look for prepare thick smear, thin smear, and treat with animal. Which animal is the first line?
Artemisinin combination therapies.
Oh, no. Even now, if it is chloroquine sensitive, you can go for chloroquine. What's the total dose of chloroquine?
25 mg/kg.
Right? 3
dose. Loading dose is 10 mg/kg. Then 10 mg/kg after 24 hours. Then 5 mg/kg after 48 hours.
Okay. So it is 25 mg/kg. Okay. Either you can give 10, 5, 5. That is 10 mg/kg is 10, 5 mg/kg of 68 hours, 5 mg/kg next day, 5 mg/kg next day. Or you can give today 10 mg/kg, tomorrow 10 mg/kg, and third day 5 mg/kg. And plus, if it is falciparum, priamycin single dose, or other species, falciparum for 2 weeks. Other particular. Not responding, you can go for your. Viral hepatitis, you know. Supportive measures. Okay. You should know the management of hepatic encephalopathy, hepatic failure. How will you follow up the child if it is especially hepatitis B or hepatitis C? And you should know the various antivirals used for treatment, like lamivudine, gamma interferon, pegylated interferon. You should know how to diagnose hepatitis A, hepatitis B, and how will you know whether hepatitis B is infective?
Okay.
Then, if it's autoimmune hepatitis, how will you diagnose?
Sir, you can do antibodies like anti-LKM antibodies, anti-smooth muscle antibodies. Then immunoglobulin G will be elevated. ANA will be elevated.
Elevated. And on the treatment?
Steroids, prednisone can be given, sir.
Very good. Okay. So autoimmune hepatitis, you make a diagnosis and treat steroid as a treatment. And again, make sure, because this can, this is a chronic disease and it can remit and relapse. Okay. So autoimmune hepatitis, you have to follow up the child for a long period. HLS, there are five out of eight criteria and make a diagnosis and also go for a either bone marrow study or a CSF study and look for hemophagocytosis and treat with cytotoxic drugs or steroids. Okay. Tuberculosis, already paranyu. You know, diagnosis ariyamallo, have a chest x-ray, have a manto, pinne gastric gas weight adakku nokka and go for. I think with that, I think we can summarize, because the time is again 2 hours, 9:30.
Okay,
so anything else by anyone? Or else, I hope at least you have gained something from today's discussion.
Yes.
Anyway, your presentation was good and you have backed it very well also. Okay, thank you, Nida. Thank you, IAP Cochin, especially Dr. Pramod Vairi, for being with us. Because generally it will be boring for such a leading practitioner to be here for quite a long time. So thank you especially for Dr. Pramod Vairi, and also thank you for AJP Bench.
Just learning.
Over to Dr. Pramod.
Thank you very much, sir. I hope I'm audible.
Yeah, definitely.
So, Dr. Nita, you can stop sharing out.
Yes.
Okay. So after a very exhaustive session, we have come to a conclusion, and I must thank Dr. Hariprasad sir for being gentle with the PG, because there was a lot of apprehension because Dr. Jayakumar sir was like in a different wavelength with the first session. So I think now with your session, the PGs have regained their confidence in terms of presenting, and their apprehensions have been solved by you. Thank you very much, sir, for that. And thank you, Dr. Nita, for the wonderful presentation. And thank you, everyone, for joining us. And we have a IAP YouTube channel, IAP Cochin YouTube channel. So if you go and subscribe there, you can attend the Pediatric Potpourri, which is exclusively meant for pediatric PGs. And a vast number of topics have been covered. And in fact, the day after, we'll be dealing with thalassemia. And we have experts from CMC Vellore and Bangalore. So do join us. And there will be a PG quiz after that. And very rarely, PGs from Cochin join the program. And most of it is from Trivandrum or other places who bag the prizes. So I request you all to join the program and attend it. In case you are not able to attend it, it is always available on the YouTube channel, IAP Cochin Branch. Please subscribe the channel. And once again, thank you all. And I conclude the session by expressing profuse thanks to Dr. Hariprasad sir and Dr. For presenting. And thank you all.
Okay. Dr. Nita. Okay. Thanks a lot.
Thanks.
Thanks a lot, Dr. Pramod. Thank you, Dr.